Leonard Lake and Charles Ng. On the 2nd of June 1985, San Francisco police arrested a middle-aged, bearded white man to whose parked car a young Oriental had just brought a stolen vice that he'd been observed shoplifting. The white man gave his name as Robin Stapley and was found to be carrying a silenced pistol, a federal offence. As police prepared to take a statement from him at the station, he asked for a glass of water and swallowed a cyanide pill. Now, heavens to Betsy! That was going a bit far to avoid petty charges of receiving stolen goods and possessing an illegally silenced gun. The dead man's fingerprints told a more elaborate story, however. He was not Robin Stapley, 26-year-old founder of the San Francisco Guardian Angels. He was an ex-Marine called Leonard Lake. After discharge from the Marines in 1971, he had married. The marriage proved short-lived. His obsession with manacles and bondage, his need to photograph his partner tied up in humiliating positions, all proved too much for Mrs. Lake. Nor was she thrilled, any more than his neighbours, by his passion for military survival activities. Like Donald Nappy, the Black Panther, he collected militaria, dressed up in combat fatigues, seemed to be preparing for a lone life in a violent and hostile world where only some sort of John Wayne could come through. Despite his love of personal combat training, he had not seemed good military material to the Marines, however. They had discharged him for psychiatric problems after 2 years' treatment had failed to straighten him out. Lake took a succession of handyman or caretaker-type jobs, and he certainly was good with his hands. He bought a small remote ranch at the foot of the Sierra Nevadas in Calaveras County, and behind his frame house, he excavated and constructed a deep bunker, covering it over with cinder blocks and burying it out of sight. It was to be his nuclear shelter, he said. He remarried in 1980. His second wife, Cricket Balash, found some at least of his eccentricities tolerable. She worked as a teacher's aide at a school, and she shared her husband's peculiar belief that all children ought to know how to make explosives. It would be useful for ranching and farming kids, they argued, to be able to dynamite obstructive tree stumps from their land. The argument seems just as silly as the dreadful Dr. Edward Teller's claim that his revolting invention, the hydrogen bomb, would prove highly useful to humanity in changing the course of inconvenient rivers. It seems that brilliant scientists and loony janitors alike come up with peculiar claims about constructive earth moving when they find that normal people don't share their dangerous and destructive small boy wish to make big bangs. Of course, the high school principal turned the Lake's potty suggestion down flat. Nevertheless, Lake stockpiled arms and explosives himself and in the early 1980s collected a couple of convictions for illegal possession of explosives and for stealing building materials for his bunker. Cricket Balash decided that a criminal husband was not for her and divorced him. I don't know whether she'd been confronted with Leonard's appetite for bizarre bedroom games or not. After this, Lake's closest associate became young Charles Ng, a wealthy ne'er-do-well from Hong Kong who had also served in the Marines. And while Ng had not been sent for compulsory psychiatric treatment, he'd left a rather Lake-like reputation as a weirdo. He boasted of his great skill in the martial arts, sometimes claiming to be the reincarnation of a great ninja warrior. He hinted that he'd killed at least one man. He was generally viewed with some reservations by his comrades in arms. He now spent a good deal of time with Leonard Lake, the young Chinese frequently wearing a T-shirt that read, "Mercenaries do it for money." And what mercenaries do for money, killing, it turned out was indeed the way Lake enjoyed himself while with Ng. A surprising number of people, single women, single men, and young couples, had disappeared after making friends with Ng or Lake or both. That Robin Stapley, whose identity Lake had been assuming when arrested, for example, and his landlord and landlady. The reason for their disappearance emerged when the police searched Lake's ranch house and bunker. The house contained a mass of weaponry and survival kit. Also, a lot of expensive video equipment, much of it stolen. Also, a large quantity of pornography. The bedroom was fitted out with manacles and harnesses, and the general bizarre but not necessarily dangerous toys and fetishy dressing-up things of an extreme bondage and sadomasochism enthusiast. But a little closet with a two-way mirror leading to the bunker invited more serious consideration. It was stuffed with women's sexy undies. Was Leonard Lake also occasionally transvestite? Or did he invite his sexual partners to help themselves to dressing-up clothes and peek on them while they tried them on? Certainly the two-way mirror is one of the dodgiest of sex toys, since its only possible use is for intrusive voyeurism. A trapdoor in this closet led to the bunker, and here things rapidly became worse. In the bunker's principal playroom, a large bed was fitted with eye bolts so that an occupant could be spread-eagled on it. The mattress was covered with dark stains. Blood. The pornography held in the bunker was much more personal and much more sinister than the commercial stuff upstairs. Videos showed a large number of young women tied to chairs and threatened by Lake and Ung. They would have their clothes torn off them with a bayonet. They were visibly terrified, as Lake said to them things like, "By cooperating with us, that means you'll stay here as our prisoner. You'll work for us, you'll wash for us, you'll fuck for us, or you can say no, in which case we'll tie you to the bed, we'll rape you, and then we'll take you outside and shoot you." The women, clearly not actresses nor willing participants, were shown being forced to shower with Ung, and then, sweet and clean for their ordeal, they were tied down and raped anyway, and sodomized, and tortured. Screaming faces flashing past the lens could be identified as people known to Lake and Ung, who had mysteriously disappeared. Some of these victims were mere teenagers. And where were they? The discovery of a quantity of dumped bones and skeletons nearby supplied part of the answer. The pornographic journal of Leonard Lake supplied more. It talked of taking the men whose women he wanted, turning them loose in the desert, and going after them with a rifle, hunting humans. It wrote of his fantasy, partly inspired by John Fowle's novel The Collector, of having a collection of sex slaves in the bunker. It expressed his contemptuous attitude to women. "Women are like books. You put them on the shelf and take them down when you need them. You train them to do what you want. God meant women for cooking, cleaning house and sex, and when they're not in use they should be locked up." One journal started with the remark, "Death is in my pocket and fantasy my goal." There can be little doubt that most of the women filled by Leonard Lake met death. He had offered them the choice of compliance or rape and murder. Then, when they complied, brutally tied them up and raped them and sodomized them anyway. No doubt he then carried out the rest of his threat. He was no loss to mankind when he swallowed his cyanide. And what about his friend Charles Ung? Well, he escaped pursuers who had seen him steal the vice and made his way to Canada. There, another piece of incompetent shoplifting led to his arrest and identification. But Canada, which does not have the death penalty, does not willingly extradite criminals to countries where they might be executed. Ung and his lawyers fought against extradition for years, but in the end they lost. And a couple of years ago, Mr. Ung went back to California, stood trial, was convicted, and sentenced.